Good morning and welcome to the Deanery Garden at Canterbury Cathedral on this morning of Monday, the 18th of April. It's Easter Monday, and the Monday of Easter week, Easter Monday, is always here a public holiday, a bank holiday as they're called here in England, and that means that the banks are closed, and this is very much one of them, so that outside there is a quietness which generally isn't there in the streets, because people are having a resting day here. And we've come into the garden to say our prayers with you on this first day after Easter Day. So this is in effect the second day of the week for Easter week. Easter Day, of course, the first day of the week when they came to the tomb. And we continue our rejoicings for Eastertide, for Easter, like Lent, goes on for 40 days, and we mustn't forget that this is a major festival for all that time, proclaiming the resurrection, a festival of great joy, and the word most used, which was not allowed through the whole of Lent, is Alleluia. And we say that, Alleluia, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, Alleluia. We say that on this Easter Monday, as we shall now, for 40 days, until we get to the Feast of Pentecost. Well, here we are in the garden, and we start with our prayers for Ukraine, of course, because the people of Ukraine, whether in Ukraine still or taking shelter and being given hospitality in other places, separated often as families, are needing our prayers more than ever. So we continue that urgent prayer for peace in Ukraine and for Christ's peace across the world. For the peace of the risen Christ is the gift that he constantly gives to those to whom he appears. And that word is one of the words of the resurrection narrative, which repeats itself again and again. But this morning we have a special narrative. It's the traditional narrative, as the Book of Common Prayer used to give us, written out in full on the Monday of Easter week. And it's not from St. John's Gospel, but when we've said our opening prayers, then we shall tell that narrative, and I'll explain much more where we are and why we're here and what the symbols around me represent. But until then, you can probably begin yourself to put together this story. I have the robin sitting here beside me on a twig, and he's being very brave above the daffodils. He's knowing that Tiger's having his breakfast. Good morning, Mr. Robin. Hello, how are you this morning? So many of the birds at the moment are having the time when their wife are nesting, and so we see solitary birds like the magpie and the crow and a blackbird, a male blackbird with its yellow bill, by themselves while those eggs are hatched, and then they'll be very busy helping to feed. So let's say our prayers on this morning, and we rejoice in the Easter season. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. In your resurrection, O Christ, let heaven and earth rejoice. Alleluia. Blessed are you, Lord God of our salvation. To you be praise and glory forever. As once you ransomed your people from Egypt and led them to freedom in the promised land, so now you have delivered us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of your risen Son. May we, the first fruits of your new creation, rejoice in this new day you have made and praise you for your mighty acts. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. The night has passed and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. Our psalm this morning, on this 18th morning of the month, is Psalm 92. It is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord, and to sing praises to your name, O Most High, to tell of your love early in the morning, and of your faithfulness in the night time. Upon the 10-stringed instrument, upon the harp, and to the melody of the lyre, For you, Lord, have made me glad by your acts, and I sing aloud at the work of your hands. O Lord, how glorious are your works! Your thoughts are very deep. The senseless do not know, nor do fools understand, that their wickedness sprouts like grass, and all the workers of iniquity flourish. It is only to be destroyed forever. But you, O Lord, shall be exalted for evermore. For lo, your enemies, O Lord, your enemies shall perish, and all the workers of iniquity shall be scattered. But my horn you have exalted like the horns of wild oxen. I am anointed with fresh oil. My eyes will look down on my foes. My ears shall hear the ruin of the evildoers who rise up against me. And the righteous shall flourish like a palm tree, and shall spread abroad like a cedar of Lebanon. Such as are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bear fruit in old age. They shall be vigorous and in full leaf, that they may show that the Lord is true. He is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. So we come to our reading, not in the Gospel of St. John, but today in the Gospel of St. Luke. And for this, we have set a scene. It's a scene of a path coming towards this spot of homeliness here at the end of the path, and a covering like a roof of shelter. And our covering is full of flowers because it's this huge spreading cherry tree in full blossom. And along the path are flowers of freshness and Easter colour springing up. And the table is set for those who need hospitality to arrive. And we have here, even on the mug that I'm using this morning, the sign of resurrection glory. It's a mug with a goldfinch on it. And the goldfinch in medieval tradition had been rather a dull bird, but it was the bird who, taking pity on Christ as he carried his cross, came down and plucked thorns from the crown of thorns to give some kind of ease and refreshment. And for that reason, the goldfinch's face is red. And then the other colours given by heaven for that act of grace, the white of purity of intention, and the black of the night in which Jesus was in the tomb, which then, in colours of glory, the yellow of the goldfinch's breast and back here. This is an English goldfinch, not an American goldfinch. So the goldfinch here is a sign of resurrection glory, but what it cost Christ and the goldfinch to be pierced with thorns. You probably guessed the story I'm going to read. It's in St. Luke's Gospel. It's a wonderful narrative, and it's a narrative that appears in this form only in the Gospel of St. Luke. It's chapter 24 and verses 13 to 35, a wonderful narrative. That very day, that's the day of the resurrection, Easter day for us, two of the disciples were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went along with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him, and he said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" He said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death, and they had him crucified. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, Stay with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is now far spent. So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at table with them, he took the bread, and blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. It's a wonderful narrative, and if one thinks of it in the two parts, first the time of unrecognition and then the simplicity of the time of recognition, they are slowly traveling along the road to Emmaus from Jerusalem, going home, a 6 or 7 mile journey, we're told. And their hearts are sad. And that sadness is communicated, no doubt, by the slow speed and the way in which they're talking to each other. And as they go along, a stranger joins them. And their eyes are kept from recognizing that this stranger is Jesus. But the evangelist lets us into the secret straight away. They plod their path along, and the stranger asks them what they were talking about. Then they begin to tell the expectations that they had had. And these are two of the disciples, not of the 12, but of the community of disciples of Jesus. One of them called Cleopas, the other is unnamed. And they begin to tell what has befallen them and all the company that had hoped that Jesus was the one who would redeem Israel. And then Jesus says to them, O slow of heart to believe all that the prophets and scriptures have told you. Later on, those scriptures in the same chapter are said also to be law and psalms too, just as we keep finding pieces of prophecy in the psalms which refer directly to the anointed one, to the Christ. And Jesus is slow of heart to believe all that the scriptures have told. And then as they go along, he expounds to them all those scriptures which tell how it was necessary that, and if one is thinking of the prophet Isaiah, the suffering servant of the Lord must suffer and die. That was part of the vocation before the glory of resurrection. But still, their eyes are not opened. And then they arrive at the village of Emmaus. Now let's say straight away that there is no certainty where Emmaus was. People have identified it as this place, that place, but it's not a place that we know. And in a strange way, I'm glad of that, because it becomes any home. Where they were going has now been veiled in history by not knowing which village we're talking about. But what we are talking about is a place of hospitality and welcome, because as the stranger makes to go on, the two who are going into their own home say to the stranger, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to stay with them. It's a compline sentence, isn't it? Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And in going in, they offer him supper. And now we come to the point of recognition. Here's half a loaf from last night's supper. And I'm holding it here in my hands, the most simple sign of nourishment from all that is grown on the earth. And an instant sign of that Last Supper which Jesus took with his disciples. And that Last Supper appears in each of the Gospels. And Jesus at that supper took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and then he gave it to them, and he used the words, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. We get that from not only the Synoptic Gospels, but also from St. Paul himself in the early verses of 1 Corinthians 15. All of those things we are told, and the church constantly since that time has taken bread in that way. But on this night, it becomes the sign of recognition. Lovely smell of bread as I hold the loaf. And in those hands, taking the bread and blessing it and breaking it and offering it to them, their eyes are opened to see Jesus. As the Greeks had said in the temple courtyard to Philip, sir, we would see Jesus. With Mary in the garden yesterday, when we were dealing with that, the Easter morning story in the Gospel of St. John, when the light of day was fully there, and Mary, thinking that Jesus is the gardener, is speaking to him, and she recognizes him then by his saying of her name. Now, it's the hands breaking the bread and giving it to them that causes them to know that this is indeed the risen Christ. And having had that recognition, there is, in one way, no more need for that physical presence being there. That now is rather like the beloved disciple at the tomb. He saw and believed and went home again. Here they are in their homes. Their pace up until now has been completely slow. And now suddenly everything changes. By recognition, they have the energy to run back to Jerusalem, hasten back to Jerusalem. All those miles they'd covered are as nothing now as they go with the good news to tell it. And they find that their news is replicated by what the 12 are saying, that the Lord is risen and he has appeared to Simon. And as that is proclaimed, we have that sense of another of the Gospels, Luke, finding the narrative that pleases them most. Just as we had the lovely story of Mary Magdalene thinking Jesus to be the gardener and then becoming the one who ran to tell the disciples that she had seen the Lord, so too these go to tell their story, and that all of those things are beginning to give the recognition of Jesus, who, and we'll do this on another morning, who is going to give his church the gift that he himself has been giving to the world, even to the cost of his own life on the cross. All of those things are encompassed in this narrative, but the recognition comes from a simple act of hospitality, and that sense of the sentence in the epistle to the Hebrews, the letter to the Hebrews, be not forgetful to entertain strangers. And then the verse goes on, for in so doing some have entertained angels unawares. And by the word angels, one thinks that the writer is talking about Abraham entertaining the three angels who come with the news of the birth of a son of promise for him. But be not forgetful to entertain strangers could equally apply to this one. The stranger was intending to go on, and they invite him in to share their supper. And then in the breaking of bread, then they recognize him. His hands had often done that for them. And one thinks also of the feeding of the 5,000, when the same thing was in place, taking the loaves, raising his eyes to heaven and giving thanks, breaking them and giving them to the disciples to distribute. All of those things in that sign of bread, this is my body, this is how the world will be nourished by my body and your bodies, is the inference as he gives them the bread. A wonderful Easter sign for this Monday following the day of Easter, but actually the story taking place on the night of Easter Day. And we remember on this morning just how much this command has been obeyed throughout the world in so many different circumstances. There's a wonderful passage by Dom Gregory Dix which says, was ever a command so obeyed? And then in that passage he describes the various places in states of enormous distress, states of right towards the end of life, of communities which can think of nothing more than to do this, or in the regularity of all Sunday worship, or whenever Christians meet together to break bread. And then there's the time of great joy at a marriage, or at the most important festivals of the year. We can think of nothing better than breaking the bread and distributing it as the sign of Christ in us. And we pray that our eyes may be open not only to see Jesus, but to be Jesus by taking the bread inside us and then going out to convey that gift of good news to the world and transformation and the opening out of our spiritual vision and the divine image to eternity. All those things are contained in the sense of the bread, in being broken. I don't even have to break this loaf to smell its wonderful savour. But at the same time, when a new loaf is broken open, there is that wonderful scent. This scene has been so often painted and used, but I think most simply of our little chapel. I said to you, I think 2 weeks ago, I was leaving morning prayer to go and celebrate communion for the community of Jesus Hospital, which is sheltered accommodation for elderly folk who need just a bit more care than their own home. And the chapel there, which looks out to the south, I think, because the sun seems to shine through the window when I'm celebrating mid-morning. And the window is a simple telling of the story in more modern glass of the road to Emmaus. Not the journey, but the breaking of bread. Jesus is there breaking the bread, and the two at the table the moment the scales fall from their eyes and they recognize Jesus. And it's in front of that, I can't see it when I'm celebrating, it's behind me, but all the people that are seeing the altar with the bread set out for them, which they will participate in, are looking at that biblical scene, that narrative above, which then becomes present tense in their own lives. And the sense of being vigorous and in full leaf in old age in a place of sheltered accommodation becomes very, very apparent when one tells this story. So we give thanks for this sign given and received, for the fact that the creation of bread, and in some parts of the world it's made with wheat and in others with a different staple crop, but nearly every society has a staple crop which provides basic nourishment. And if I put the loaf back here, that's what this story is all about. The path, the invitation, the sheltering hospitality, and then the gift given. And the real gift, not in the bread itself, but the recognition of what that bread means, and the sense of being able then, by that gift, to be Jesus to one another. I don't want to use any dates today, because I think one could say that this date, lived out through history, is a date in itself. And the fact that so many tables, so many altars, bear that stamp. But what I would want to say is that it teaches us that not only in the formal way that the church does this, in the celebration of whatever your communion calls this, the Lord's Supper, the Eucharist, the Mass, all of those things, the Holy Communion, so many different words for this when it's done formally, but for all Christians and for all of us who would see Jesus in one another, the taking and sharing of food with each other and the giving and sharing of hospitality becomes a sacrament in its own right. So that every meal, not just when there's bread on the table, when there's anything on the table being given and shared, is something which becomes a sacrament in which we may see Jesus, and we pray that others may see Jesus in us. It's the simplest of truths, but in that recognition, as their eyes are opened and they see Jesus, in that recognition, that whole Christian sacramental truth is contained. And we give thanks for that wideness of the way in which creation proclaims its Creator. The Psalms, which Jesus teaches the disciples to find him in, as he does with the Law and the Prophets and the whole created order around him, the Psalms contain image after image of the way the Creator gives himself to us, but all are pointing towards the physicality of the Word made flesh, full of grace and truth, being handed on now to us by a gift which is still to be given as we explore these Easter narratives during this Easter week. So God bless this day to you as we say our prayers this morning. I'm using the collect for Easter Day, and you will bring your own prayers and intentions to this. You will think of the hospitality and all that you are receiving from one another on this day. It's a day of joy, a day of celebration, and here in England, very much a family day when people come together. I think that we will need to just give a bit more hospitality to our friend the Robin, who is looking for a bit more than just bread. He'll see that in no time at all, I'm sure. He's just around and looking. So, prayers today are for, in the Anglican Communion, on the 18th of April, the Diocese of Kwara, in the Church of Nigeria, the Kwara province. And here in the Canterbury Diocese, the villages and communities around Ospringe, and we're praying for clergy there some in retirement and some living there who do other tasks, but with permission to officiate, if you say, who help in the parishes. There's a very long list of them, so I'm not going to read them all, but they will know who they are as we pray for clergy with permission to officiate in the Ospringe area of our diocese, the area deanery. And we pray for Justin, our Archbishop, for Rose, Bishop of Dover, for Emma, Bishop at Lambeth, and here is the prayer for Eastertide, for Easter Day, and this week. Lord of all life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the old order of sin and death to make all things new in him, grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise and honour, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. So bringing your own prayers and intentions of thankfulness and joy in this Easter season, but also for those that you know need our prayers in any kind of sickness, sorrow or danger today. We say the prayer our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So time for your own reflections now on this Easter Monday.
Once he walked beside me, like he'd been there all along. Not a stranger, but a father who can sense when something's wrong. And he answered all my questions, and he understood my fears that somehow vanished now that he was here. Can't you see who walks with you? Can't you hear who speaks your name? Can't you feel something stirring in your heart? How his words ring strong and true, like a once familiar strain. Can the paths we follow from now on be the same? I couldn't bear for him to leave me, so I begged him please to stay, spend the evening, a few moments before he went his way. Then like a host he stood and blessed me, broke the bread and poured the wine. Then I knew there was something there I recognized. Yes, I can see who walks with me. I can hear who speaks my name. I can feel something stirring in my heart. How his words ring strong and true, like a once familiar strain, and I know see who walks with me. I can hear who speaks my name. I can feel something stirring in my heart. How his words still ring strong and true, like a once familiar strain, and I know I'll never be the same. I can see. I can see. I can see.
The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, upon those whom you love, and those whom you would pray for this Eastertide and always. Amen. Well, our friend the robin certainly found where we put the food bowl. Now, Tiger has changed his position and he's feeling a bit safer to come down and feed here. Not that you would do anything to the robin, would you? You're a very gentle cat, we know. Let's look at our riddle for a bit of fun on this day of Easter week. Yesterday I asked, I'm lighter than a feather, yet the strongest man can't hold me for more than 5 minutes. What am I? Actually, it's the same answer as one of those that we had yesterday. It's your breath. You can't hold your breath, however strong you are, for more than 5 minutes without keening over and fainting so that your body would start breathing again. And then the second was, and this is a sort of crosswordy type thing, I am the beginning of the end of every place. I am the beginning of eternity, the end of time and space. Yes, Fletcher's got it. It's the letter E, the beginning of the word end, the end of every, and the word place. I am the beginning of eternity, the end of the words time and space, the letter E. Well then, let's go on. These are medium difficult now. The more holes that you cover, the lower I will go. What am I? And then, you use me from your head to your toes. The more I do, the less of me remains. What am I? As I say, these are medium difficult now, so we can puzzle about them a bit more. Hello, Robin, you're back. Hi. Now, don't start getting interested, Tiger, because he knows that you're quite a gentle cat, really. And here's the other book. There's not many of these left, actually, but they'll see us through a day or two of this week. Today, wonderful, we're actually looking at the starling. Now, starlings, when much more than when I was growing up, probably for the first 30 or 40 years of my life, starlings were very, very common indeed. Huge flocks of starlings would gather. They then became less common, but we see them here on the lawns now, and they're comic birds. They walk along in rows. They don't hop like blackbirds, they walk. And what they are is the most tremendous mimics, so that they can mimic the song of other birds. And it's almost as if they're having fun with it. They'll do three bars of a thrush's note and then break down into a starling's laugh. And they do it to one another, as though they're making fun by these imitations of other birds, more serious birds who sing beautiful songs. So here's the starling. And they're really lovely, funny birds. They're like the Gilbert and Sullivan of the birds' race, that what they do in terms of their music makes good fun and no harm in it of the other birds in all their seriousness. So here we are, the acrostic. Should green as moss be mixed with blue of steel, be mixed with gleam of gold, you'd still fall short by far of the tar-bright, oil-slick sheen and gloss of starling wing. And if you sampled sneaker squeaks and car alarms and phone ringtones, you'd still come nowhere near the rooftop, rip-rap, street-smart hip-hop of starling song. Let shade clasp, coal clasp, pitch clasp, storm clasp, which they'd still be pale beside the in-the-dead-of-night black, cave-black, head-cocked, fight-back gleam of starling eye. Northern lights teaching shoaling fish, teaching swarming flies, teaching clouding ink would never learn the ghostly swirling, surging, whirling, melting murmuration of starling flock. Now the amazing thing is when they gather, and I think probably, oh no, yeah, we got it, on the page, here, look. Here is a huge starling flock, which was quite common. And sometimes you still see this. They gather on telephone wires in great, great murmurations of song and cackling and laughing, and they make imitations of telephone sounds and all sorts of things. And then when they fly, they swirl and swirl and swirl in the sky in great flocks. They are the most entertaining birds, and we give thanks for them, and give thanks for the multiplicity and diversity of creation on this day of resurrection, of Eastertide and Easter glory. So may you have the happiest and loveliest day today, and think of all those who might be encouraged by a contact or a gesture of help, remembering that those hands of Jesus breaking the bread were recognized not only to see Jesus, but also to be Jesus. May we be that to one another on this day in Eastertide.